mercy reigns and we lift up. We lift up. We lift our hands to you. We stand in awe with voices raised. We never cease to be amazed. With open hearts we come to you.
It's a joyous noise, right?
And we're finishing with Emmanuel?
Nope, that's actually extra.
Mary, did you know it was the last one?
Yeah, marriage.
Okay.
Kate, what are you doing here? Services
I guess we're good to go. So I say good morning and welcome to all of you who are watching this morning, Sunday morning service from Calvary Assembly of God. We're virtual for one this last week, and then Lord willing, next Sunday we'll be back in person. Just want to give you an update. A couple weeks ago, we had had a family in church that later that week had ended up being tested positive for coronavirus, and so out of an abundance of caution, we took 2 weeks just to make sure there were no other issues. We're thankful that there was no spread. And the three people that were quarantined because of contact did not have positive tests either, so they came back negative. So we're thankful we'll be able to go back into a regular in-person service starting next Sunday. And also Christmas Eve, I'll say more about that later on. But we're glad that you're here today, and we're going to open our service with prayer, and then opening song, and then the lighting of our Advent wreath. So let's pray. Lord, for this Sunday gathering, again virtually, certainly not the ideal, it's not what it was intended to be when the church gathers together as the people of God, but for now, it's what we've been given, and Lord, we want to choose to respond in a way that is biblical, that glorifies you, so that although separated by miles, we can, united in spirit, glorify God. And we pray, Lord, that this service would bring honor to your name, that there would be the anointing of the Spirit, that even though we're separated, there will be those who will be watching that will sense the presence of God in their homes, living rooms or kitchens or dining rooms, wherever they're watching this service, and that you would bring a word of hope and encouragement in this time of year, in this season. As we look back over a previous year, it's just been a crazy year, but Lord, you have remained faithful to your promises and to your people. And so therefore, we in faith and response can give you praise. And we glorify you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Feel free to stand and join us with Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Hark the Herald Angels Sing. That's right.
Shepherds. And the candle we light this morning is the angel's candle, but let me light the ones from before. Prophecy candle, the Bethlehem candle, the shepherd's candle, and finally the angel's candle. And you'll notice that the circle is now complete, but not every candle has been lit. The middle candle is the Christ candle, and this one will be lit on Christmas Eve, indicating that the light has come into the world, Jesus is born, and it's also a reminder to us that Jesus is coming again. It says here in Luke chapter 2, suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests."
Feel free to stand. We're going to continue worshiping.
We're gathered in your us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Let the church sing, show us.
Cares, oh God. So much on our minds, Lord. So much on our hearts, oh God. We lay it before you. All hindrances aside. Resting our heart in your abundance, in your abundant love, oh Jesus.
Coming here, there's so much on my mind. The cares of this whole world keep my heart so entwined. Coming here, I lay them all aside. In sweet surrender, it's your peace that
of your love. Whoa, whoa. My heart.
sings a brand new song. The debt is paid, these chains are gone. Emmanuel, God with us. Such a tiny offering compared to Calvary. Nevertheless, we lay it at your feet. Such a tiny offering compared to Calvary. Nevertheless, we lay this at your feet. Chains are gone, Emmanuel, God with us. Such a tiny offering compared to Calvary. Nevertheless, we lay this at your
Jesus.
just adore Him. We bow before You. We give You all glory and honor, God. We give You praise, for You are my righteousness. I worship You.
There is none like You, O Lord. Following the message today, we're going to take prayer requests. So if you have any, if you would like to send them in to my cell phone, that number should be showing up on your screen. It's 518-231-5098, and we'll make sure to take those. Today, Pastor Mark is going to be bringing the Word of God to us. We were going to have him do it a few weeks ago, and then it didn't work out. And then it almost didn't work out today, but I'm glad that you are doing well and you're going to come on down. We're going to have you guys afterwards come back up. I saw you have more to, yeah. So Pastor Mark, come on down.
Thanks, guys. Wow, it's always exciting to be in a empty house, I guess. I don't know. No, it's really good to be here. What Pastor Ray is alluding to is I had a normal procedure a couple weeks ago, and they gave me an experimental drug to try to clean out my system, and it totally messed my system up. And so I have been struggling with some repercussions of that. So, but it has been good. God has been gracious, and I have definitely spent some time in prayer, and it's just really good here to be here with everybody today. We're a couple days away from Christmas, the greatest day of the year. Who doesn't love Christmas? Everybody loves Christmas. Most people love Christmas, I should say. So this message today is about the birth of Christ and the importance of it, with a little bit of Jesus' life and to the end of His life at the cross, to kind of take a cliff note version of the New Testament. And I believe that Jesus' birth is the greatest moment of mercy that God had ever poured out on humanity. A moment of compassion that He gave to all of humanity so that humanity could have an opportunity to experience and to know God more deeply. And it's just amazing when you think about all of the prophecies and you think about all of the things that had to happen for Jesus' birth to occur and for basically for us to even be here and Christianity to be still a live and functioning faith that still is real and relevant to this day. But let us open in prayer. Father, we thank You and we praise You for this day. Lord, we thank You that this started with a young man and a young woman. At least Christmas did, a young man and a young woman, Mary and Joseph, who were willing to put it all on the line, willing to trust, willing to endure embarrassment, so that they would fulfill what You have called them to fulfill. We thank You for them. We thank You for Your word today, and we just ask that You would bless it. And Holy Spirit, we ask that You would move in us, and that your word would resonate in the hearts of the people. In Jesus' name. We're going to go to Luke 1, 26 through 35. And this is where Mary has an intervention by the angel Gabriel. And it says, in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to the city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you. But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great. He will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And his kingdom there will be no end. And Mary said to the angel, how will this be, since I am a virgin? And the angel answered her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, Son of God. Taking a 16-year-old girl, having an angel show up in front of you, in front of her, had to pretty much freak her out. Most people never have experiences with angels. They're impressive when you see them. But to be told, even further, that you are favored of God. Most humans, most people have trouble with recognizing and understanding that God has a purpose, God has a value in us. This young lady, I think in this moment, was struggling with, what do you mean I have favor with God? And she's troubled. So, but she's also a good Jewish lady. She knew scripture. And she knew that in the future, there was a Messiah to come. Can I ask you to get my water for me, please? I'm dying. Thank you. One of the side effects, dry mouth. Thank you very much. And she knew the Old Testament. I mean, it was very common for the family to teach openly in their home. And so the whole family would study. The whole family would know scripture. She would have known Isaiah 9:6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. I wonder, in that moment when the angel shows, if she was thinking, I am going to be the mother of God. Now, my wife and I were never blessed with children. We're youth pastors, and so we kind of get some of the pressures. But is enough pressure being a parent? But being the parent of God? I mean, there's some really bad jokes here. You know, the mom could always definitely go, my son's perfect. But there had to be pressure. There had to be a lot of fear. What about doubt? What about all the things going on in her mind? To know that your son would be fully God and fully human at the same time, how would you raise that child? How would you teach him? So if we fast forward over to Joseph has a similar situation occur. Matthew 1, 18 through 25. Now the birth of Jesus took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of God appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, God with us. That's Isaiah 7:14. Moment of life-changing experience. This continues on, and Joseph woke up from sleep, and he did as the angel of the Lord commanded. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had conceived, or until she had given birth to the son, and he called his name Jesus. See, Joseph was a respectful man. Joseph, being a good Jewish man, had a right to divorce her because he thought that she was an adulterer. But it took God's intervention and his willingness. Joseph had to be willing to listen to what the Holy Spirit and what God had been directing him to do. And in that moment, we see one of the greatest miracles to ever occur, a miracle of mercy. One of the most important things in Jewish custom was education. They would teach their children. There's no doubt in my mind that Mary and Joseph would spend hours upon hours teaching their children. There's no doubt in my mind that they attended synagogue frequently, that they prayed as a family. There's no doubt in my mind that Jesus memorized the Torah, the first five books of the Bible. And they did it as a family. Again, we go back to that pressure being placed on two people. You know, Jesus, we always talk about Jesus never sinning and never falling short, and that's so very true, but I think that he was able to do that because his parents were strong. And I think that his parents gave him abilities and gave them insight to do what he had to do. And so now let us look through a little bit of Jesus' life. We all have moments, parents have moments, youth pastors have moments, when we can be proud of the kids and the youth that are around us. I think one of the most proud moments for a parent would be when Jesus is teaching in the synagogues in Luke 14:15. He's teaching. He's teaching the people that are supposed to teach him. And everyone praises him for what he's teaching. At 12 years old, it's hard to get a 12-year-old away from a computer these days, much less read the Bible. But imagine having your 12-year-old son, or daughter for that matter, being able to go out and preach to a group of religious leaders and have them praise him. Remember, they're praising him now, but in later in life, they condemn him. And so we move forward in Jesus' life. We go to Matthew 3:13-17, when Jesus gets baptized by John the Baptist, where God speaks from heaven, "Here is my son, who I am well pleased. I think this is a monumental moment in every young person's or every person's life is when they get baptized. And I think that God is really being clear with us that that's something that we need to do in our life. But being baptized and having the skies open and doves fly out and God going, this is my son who I'm well pleased. Here's your sign. Soon after that, Jesus gets led into the desert for 40 days and 40 nights. He gets tempted by the devil. And what does Jesus do? In every moment and every time that the enemy tempts him, he stands on Scripture, something that was taught to him by his parents, something that he knew. It is written. Is how he answers every attack that Satan brings. Soon after this, Jesus starts doing miracles. And does anybody know what the first miracle that Jesus did? He turned water into wine, yes. So I find that funny, though. He turned water into wine, but in John 4, 5, it says Jesus is talking to his mother, and this is not disrespectful, but in our culture today, it would be termed disrespectful. He says, "Woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied. "My hour has not yet come." And his mother turns and looks at the servants and says, "Do whatever he tells you to." Mama, the Son of God, or the mother of God, looks at God, looks at Jesus, says, "Go turn the water into wine." Even God obeys mama, okay? Just saying. There's some humor there. I use that on the youth quite often, but we won't go down that road. So let's fast forward even a little bit further. Jesus does multiple miracles. He heals the blind. He heals the sick, he raises the dead, he casts out demons. He does a tremendous amount of things in his life. But all of it, everything, his birth, his baptism, his time in the desert, his miracles, all lead him to one place, the cross. This cute little baby in a manger that we love so much had a purpose, and that purpose was to end on the cross. Over the last 4 months, the Lord has not let me leave the cross. I have spent a significant amount of study time there, and I have found it to be nothing but rewarding. To see what Jesus did on the cross is heartbreaking. Because we are so stubborn and so stuck in our own ways. But the cross is the moment when mercy at the manger turns into grace from God. Grace being a debt paid that we can never be paid, that we can never pay. Grace enters the world. It's the greatest gift for Christmas that we could ever receive, is that grace. Ephesians 2, 8 through 9 says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not for yourself, it is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." When you have accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you have grace in your life. Your trials, your tribulations, your failures, your sins, all of those are taken care of. The greatest gift. Because doesn't that lead us to salvation? Acts 4:12. Salvation is found in no one else. For there is no one other, there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. There's a lot of things out there There's a lot of religions out there. There's a lot of people saying, oh, you can get to heaven through multiple directions. I'm sorry. That's not necessarily true. Actually, that's not true. There is only one way, and that is through Jesus Christ and what he did for you on the cross. That when you receive that grace, that you can be saved. There's some confusion out there about that salvation that Jesus offers on the cross. Some people think it's only for the elect. Some think it's only for the predestined. Some think it's only for whatever culture. There's a lot of lies out there. But God is a just God. God is a fair God. In Romans 1:16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God and it brings salvation to everyone who believes. First to the Jew, then to the Gentile. Congratulations. When Jesus dies on the cross, it not only he does away with just the Jewish rite, he brings Gentiles into the mix so that we can be saved as well, that we are not lost. It's an inclusive offer for all of humanity. It doesn't matter of your race, your creed, your sex, your gender. If you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you will be saved. Another important thing that, this is one of mine I love dearly, is we become heirs to the throne. I always wanted to be part of a kingdom. So, Galatians 4:7. So you are no longer a slave, but a son or daughter. And if a son or daughter, then an heir through God. We are heirs to the throne. We have the authority that Jesus gives us when we accept him. There is darkness in this world. You have authority. You have ability. You have the Holy Spirit walking with you, because the Holy Spirit resides in us when we accept Christ. And with that being said, there are some things in our world that we need to pray against. There are things in our own lives that we need to pray for God to break. You have the authority to do that. We don't have to live broken. We don't have to live in bondage. We can live lives free in Christ. Jesus is also, when he does give up his last breath and the veil is torn, he is a sacrifice, a full paid sacrifice for every sin that we've ever committed. In 1 Corinthians 15:3, for I passed on to you as of the first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to scriptures. Jesus died for our sins. Paid in full everything that we have ever done. If we could get people to understand that and to know that and to embrace the forgiveness that Christ truly offers, our world would change. Jesus also ushers in a personal restored relationship with God. See, we have to remember, prior to Jesus' death, a priest would enter the holies of holies once a year and do all of your sin offering once a year. I don't know if I could wait a full year to do all my sin offering. There's a lot there. John 14:25-26. All of this I have spoken while still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. The Holy Spirit walks with us. When that veil gets torn, the Holy Spirit then comes soon afterwards in the book of Acts. The disciples are waiting in the upper room and the Holy Spirit falls. And revival starts to break out. Lives are changed. For all nations, for all people, if we read the book of Acts, it's not just the Jews. There's people from all over the area that get saved. All over the area that speaking in tongues and fire dancing on their heads and all kinds of crazy stuff that the Bible talks about. But I think one of the most important things that the Holy Spirit does for us is he gives us the power to walk a life of sanctification. That every day we should try to strive to be closer to what Christ has called us to be and has made us to be. We don't always get it right. We all fall short. But we try to be more like Christ. And so there's a lot of scripture that I just went over, and there's a lot of, there's a connection here that I want to make. And the connection is, it took two people willing to trust. Angels showing up, God. One was a dream and one was an angel. To live a life that honored God, that their children honored God, and that child grew up to be the Son of God. At any point in time, things could have fallen through. And we could have talked about all the prophecies about Bethlehem. We could have talked about the prophecies and all of that. But I don't have that much time. I think the takeaway from the message of the birth of Jesus is that we never should run from divine appointments. We should be willing, as God leads and God touches our lives, to step into that role, whatever that may be. And what does it take to get there? What does it take for God to use us? We need to live a moral and upright life, because that empowers us to serve God in a way that we can't always understand. I remember when Pastor Ray and I were talking about me taking a youth pastor position, and I was praying one day, and I said, "Lord, I'm a deliverance pastor. Why do you want me to work with youth?" And the Holy Spirit flat out told me, "What, you don't think the youth need deliverance?" So often in our minds, we wrap things around what we think God wants to do, rather than being willing to let God do what he wants to do. Continually look for God's appointed times. I think when we do that, we can open doors that no one else can open. I think that's what Mary and Joseph did. There was a moment and there was an appointed time and they said, "All right, Lord, let's do it." We have to remember that Christianity and faith in the Lord is for all people. And that we need to maintain the positivity as much as we can and reach people and touch them and let them know that they're loved, that they're cared about, that there's a life beyond the garbage in this county and in this state and in this nation, in this world. There is a God that loves them, that made them, that knows them. And we see all of that. Because when I look at the nativity and I look at the baby Jesus, I actually see the beauty of the way that God's made each one of us. And then we see the horror that the world did to him. And that's really where the world wants us to be, is stuck in our hurt and our pain. So just to close, this Christmas season, seek God. He sent a baby for us that would turn into a man, that would change the world and put it on its end. He wants to use us. He started with a baby. He can use you too. Thank you.
I invite the worship team to come on up. They have a song that I don't know if they knew what Mark was preaching, but certainly ties in. It's Mary, Did You Know? Mary, Did You Know? I like it when the Holy Spirit connects the dots for us. Did Mary understand everything she was getting into when she says, here I am, here I am. Again, just a reminder, we're going to go to the Lord shortly. We've had prayer requests come in. If you have not yet texted your prayer request to me, 518-231-5098. We do want to take those requests to the Lord. But Mary, did you know?
Did you know that your baby boy would someday walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? Child that you've delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm the sea with his hand? Did you know just run when you've kissed your little baby, then you've kissed the face of God. Mary, did you know?
Wonder if she did know, because if she did, it seems to me that would put even more pressure on her. Wow. I just imagine all the other things that could happen. You know, like, can you imagine her saying to her James and all the other siblings, why can't you be more like your older brother Jesus? I mean, imagine the pressure if you're a second born there. But I love the fact that we connect Christmas to Easter. My wife and I were away for a few days. We were celebrating. She finished her degree. She'd been working on for 4 years, and so we took some time. And she was commenting as we were driving home last night, she goes, do you see how many houses don't just have Christmas lights? They have Christmas crosses. And I said, that's because the cross is connected to the creche. That you have the creche, the cross, and the crown. She goes, that's the only Christmas Eve sermon I remember you preaching in 34 years. I said, it's okay. It's okay. Coming up with something new every Christmas. But they are connected. You know, he wasn't just born to live. He was born to live so he could offer his life for us. So we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. As I said, we do have a prayer request that came in. This is from Vivian. She's asking for prayer. It's in terms of the business. It's just been a very challenging year in terms of COVID and the whole district that she's a part of with the shoe department. She said, would you just please pray? And certainly, Vivian, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer on that. We also want to continue to lift up the Schmid family. Some of you may be aware that they came down, several of the members came down with COVID, very severe. Peter was hospitalized, but he's doing better, and they expect he'll be coming out of the hospital tomorrow. So we thank God for that. So let's look to the Lord in prayer. Lord, it's because a baby was born in a manger and grew up, increased in stature and wisdom and favor with God and men, who was baptized, who is acknowledged, this is my son, my beloved son, in whom I'm well pleased. This one who was driven into the wilderness to be tempted. This last Adam who, unlike the first Adam, obeyed. And this last Adam was a perfect sacrifice without spot or blemish, who was willing to focus his life to get to the cross, but who knew the joy that was beyond the cross of what would occur. Because of that sacrifice, because of his death and resurrection, we have access to you, O God our Father, to bring our request to you in faith and to know that you are a good, good Father, that you are not absent, you are not abusive, but you are good and great. You are loving and you are just. We thank you that you don't allow us to manipulate you. We thank you that you remain sovereign God and that you are the one that we worship and honor today. And I thank you that because of what your son did, we have access to pray. Vivian has requested prayer. Her district manager is just running ragged with so many stores he's responsible for and with COVID, trying to find enough people and that aren't being quarantined and trying to keep the stores running, a lot of pressure. And Lord, Vivian's heart is not just for her own store, her own needs, but for that of her district manager. And so we pray for him, and we pray for Vivian and the team, that you would continue to give them grace and strength. Lord, we pray for the Schmids as they recover, Peter especially, as he recovers in the hospital. Lord, that temperature, 105, so severe, and yet, God, you've had mercy, because his ministry isn't done. And so we pray for him as he recovers and comes out of the hospital tomorrow. Lord, we thank you that we can lift up a request and all across this viewing area as they're watching the service for whatever that prayer request is, Lord. We don't want to just say, hey, Lord, meet my need, meet my need. Lord, we're asking you to meet the need in a way that would let us become more like Jesus, that would allow us to glorify you. Because sometimes what we think we need is not what we really need. You're wiser than we are. And you are, you're good and you know what's best. And so we pray for the best. We don't pray for what we want. We pray for what you want. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray this week all across this area as we celebrate the birth of Christ as churches will offer, some only virtual, some hybrid, some only in person, that Jesus, you would be lifted up throughout this area. We long, Lord, for the outpouring of your Spirit in our area. We long for that awakening that you have promised. when lives will be transformed by the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you that you're equipping us to share the good news. Thank you that you're working within us to be able to have this faith worth sharing. And we bless you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Make sure there's no other ones that came in. I think those were it. Nope. Let me see. Hold on. Let's see. Looks like maybe something else came in. Come on. There we go. Okay, let's go to the Lord. We just had a prayer request come in for Nancy Diaz. Let's pray. Lord, we stand in the gap. By your stripes, oh Lord Jesus, we are healed. You took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Lord, we pray and speak life with the authority of Christ to Nancy's kidneys, that you would begin to regenerate, Lord, tissue, regenerate organ that needs to be restored, that what is necessary for her healing, Lord, would be provided for her, that what Jesus did at the cross would be applied in Nancy's life, that she would know your peace, your healing, your grace, even now, that she would know the people of God all across that are watching this morning are standing in the gap and praying for her. Lord, you love Nancy. You formed her and created her with purpose, with value, with destiny. And we pray, Lord, that the final word spoken over her is life and wholeness and healing and hope and health. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. That's the last. Okay. My wife asked us if we could, and I'm going to have her lead us in prayer.
Need healing touch for just your peace on that family, and this Christmas week would be one of just joy and health for them, and just a definite moving past this time of suffering. In Jesus' name, amen.
And if you have not received Jesus as Savior, you've never come to know more than the baby in the manger that Pastor Mark talked about, please give me a call, text me, and I'd love to share with you more about the good news of Jesus Christ. It would be the greatest Christmas present you'll ever receive. We want to give you an opportunity online at our website, www.cagcobleskill.org. You have the opportunity to give. We have our tithes and offerings, but because this is the third Sunday of the month, it's also the Sunday that we emphasize missions, and I just want you to know, we're not going to read the letters today because there's very few people here because of virtual, but we've got a whole folder full of requests that have come in from our missionaries. You know, we think about how we're navigating COVID here. For the missionaries, it is particularly challenging. I got a missionary letter from one of our Chi Alpha missionaries. Chi Alpha is our college ministries. We support missionaries that go into college campuses and establish small groups and training and discipleship. This one guy has not been allowed on campus because no outside groups can come on campus because of COVID. College ministry is hands-on. You just can't Zoom it. You can't virtual it as well. So he's challenged. A lot of our missionaries are on itineration, which means they travel or are supposed to travel from church to church. But a lot of churches can't have them in because of restrictions. So as challenging as it may be for us here, some of our missionaries are really facing it. So whatever we give to missions, and I'm going to do this on behalf of the congregation, whenever we give to missions, we are helping to support their efforts. I'm so thankful for the missions heart of this church. I think it was somewhere around $12,000 this past year was given to our missionaries. Special gifts, regular monthly gifts. Just it's been a blessing to be able to support, even in the midst of COVID. But if you want to send in your checks, you can do that also. You can mail them in to the church address, P.O. Box 145, Cobleskill, New York, 12043. Or on our website, there's a little yellow oval. It says donate. You can do it there. It'll take you to PayPal. And you can give that way as well. Or next Sunday when we gather in person, you can make up for the last couple of weeks. If you are giving with the hope of taking a credit for this year, you've got to get it in by the 31st in person, or if you mail it in, it's got to be postmarked by the 31st, and it's got to be the check written for the 31st. You can't post-date. The IRS doesn't allow that, and we try to make sure we do everything with integrity when it comes to our finances. Next week, you'll have a chance to see the tentative budget for 2021. We'll have those available for you to be able to pick up. Those of you who attend Calvary want to see. Again, we try to have integrity and be transparent. You can see where all the money goes and where it's come in. So one other announcement. This week, Christmas Eve, and there was a question as to how we were going to do the service. Based upon feedback that we have received in terms of people sending in their, or when we had service a couple weeks ago, turning in the form. Also, we've put it out to the congregation. We're going to be able to do one service in person at 7 o'clock here Thursday night. Is Christmas Eve? Yep. Thursday night, 7 o'clock. We will also simultaneously broadcast it on our YouTube page at Cobleskill Calvary Assembly, so you can watch it for those that aren't comfortable coming. Now, we had a meeting this past week, Zoom meeting with our district superintendent, and he's given us some guidance. We're trying to make sure that we're not falling into paranoia on the one hand or foolishness on the other, but we also recognize Christmas Eve is a unique service. We have a lot of people that usually come to Christmas Eve that don't regularly come to our service, and so we're taking an extra layer of precaution. It's going to be an inconvenience for us, no question about it, but we're going to mask for the entire service. Those on the platform don't need to because we're more than 12, 15, 20 feet away, but we're going to have to do it for just that one-hour service. This is not something we require at every service. We recommend, but we don't require, but for Christmas Eve, because of so many people coming that aren't regulars, we just want to put that extra layer of protection for everybody. We don't want to have 2 weeks past Christmas Eve to be the church that caused a problem in the community. We know that we're over 400 cases now in the county, and we just this past Friday suffered the third death. We know that the hospitals are starting to rise in terms of hospitalizations, so we want to do our part to protect the vulnerable in our congregation. We want our 90-year-olds to still keep on serving the Lord till they get to their hundreds, and so we're asking for you to do that. We're going to have you pre-register because we're only going to be able to take 100 people for the Christmas Eve service. So if you're attending, please call in and get your spot reserved. I know there's some churches in the area that are only doing drive-by services. I know some churches in the area aren't even doing in-person at all. We're trying to balance that and provide both. But as you come in, you'll hand sanitize. Wear the mask, come on in, be seated. We're going to do one candle per family. I know in the past, normally everyone gets a candle, and then we kind of get close and pass the candle down. We're not going to do that. We're going to have two leadership team members come and light the candles for each family. So it's just a little bit different, but Christmas Eve is a very important service around here, and we don't want to cancel it. But to be able to hold it, we just have to take some extra precautions. So thank you for understanding that, but please make sure you call in and reserve your spot, because Wednesday, the Times Journal, we're going to have an advertisement, press release, letting people know in the community if they want to attend. So if you plan on attending and bringing some folks with you, we need you to call in advance and let us know so that we can get everybody pre-registered for that event.
Or they can text your number
on the screen. Oh, yeah, they can text my number, too, on the screen. 518-231-5098, and just let us know if you're coming so that we can make sure that we're all set and ready to go with that. And you got to call, tell us who's coming, how many are coming,
yes,
with the phone number, just so we can make sure we follow up with everybody in case there is an issue, which we don't believe there will be. Just a reminder, if you are sick on Sunday or have been sick the previous week, we love you, but we want to love you from a distance. Would you please just watch it virtually? We would rather not have any issues in our church. We want to keep everybody healthy. Let's get through this, get to the other side, and then we'll get back to being normal. I don't want to believe that we're in the new normal. I don't want to believe that this is the rest of our lives like this. No way. We're going to move forward in faith. But let's do what they did in Nehemiah. It says, we prayed to our God and we posted a guard. They trusted God and they acted with wisdom. So we're going to do both. So I think that's it. You got something that's going to be really good to pop us up here?
Yep. Sure.
Born in a manger was he, destined to become our Prince of Peace. Despised and rejected was he, dying and rising our King of Kings. He came to be with us, Emmanuel. He came to forgive us, Emmanuel. He came to joy fill us, Emmanuel. He came to build us a kingdom of priests, to glorify him on this earth, Emmanuel. Born of God now are we. We're drawing the lust toward the Prince of Peace. Called to forsake sin are we. In dying we rise with our King of Kings. He came to be with us, Emmanuel. He came to forgive us, Emmanuel. He came to joy fill us, Emmanuel. He came to build us his kingdom of priests, to glorify him on this earth, Emmanuel. Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Let every heart prepare him room, give glory to God, sing joy to the world, Emmanuel, come again soon. You came to be with us, Emmanuel. Yes, you came to forgive us, Emmanuel. You came to joy fill us, Emmanuel. You came to build us your kingdom of priests, to glorify you on this earth, Emmanuel, Emmanuel, Emmanuel,
Emmanuel. Wow. God with us. God did not love you from afar. God did not send an angel. He sent his son. God with us. And when Jesus was preparing to leave, he said, not only have I been with you and I'm going to go, it's important I go because then I'm going to send the Spirit. And so it goes from God with us to God indwelling us, and we become a temple of the Holy Spirit. Lord, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. We pray, Lord, as you dismiss us, you do so with your grace and with your purpose to fulfill the mission, to go on to all the world and make disciples of all nations. A message, the gospel of the kingdom. You have acted in Jesus Christ to make everything right. May we proclaim it boldly. May we proclaim it compassionately. Your goodness and greatness. In Jesus' name, amen. go in the grace of our God. We'll see you Christmas Eve at 7 o'clock, and next Sunday we'll see you in person as well at 10 o'clock. God bless.